Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Three Tequilas by Tricia O'Malley, narrated by Amy Melissa Bentley. Only the devil and I know the whereabouts of my treasure, and the one of us who lives the longest should take it all. Edward Blackbeard Teach. Chapter 1. I can't believe I'm being asked to be part of a research team. I marveled to Luna as she examined her face in front of a cut glass mirror hanging on her side of the potions and tarot shop we owned. Like she had anything to worry about. She and I both knew she used magic to keep the threat of wrinkles away from her untainted, beautiful skin. Althea Rose, there is absolutely no reason you wouldn't be asked to be a part of a research team. Luna turned and scoffed, hands on her delicate hips. Everything about Luna was delicate, from her slim build to her graceful cheekbones to the blonde sweep of her hair. She could even wear white without getting it dirty. I still hadn't gotten over that particular annoyance with Luna. She was my best friend and business partner, and we were about as alike as roses and dandelions. But our differences did little to keep us apart, and the bond between us was stronger for it. Someday, I was going to get her spell for keeping white clothes clean, even if I had to hold the scrawny bitch down and sit on her. Luna narrowed her eyes at me. You just got a decidedly evil look on your face. What were you just thinking about? I smiled sweetly at her and pushed my mass of dark curls over my shoulder. This month, I'd added some caramel streaks to my hair, which was fairly subdued for me. I was trying to tone it down a notch, as my boyfriend, Cash, led a far more normal life than I did. Being a psychic and all could be a bit off-putting for most people. And it was the "and all" part that I was trying to figure out. Nothing. I was just thinking about how to get out of my next magic lesson. I smiled brightly at Luna. Thea, you know you have magic. We've discovered that you're stronger than you realize. Don't you want to harness that power? You have no problem doing so for your tarot card readings. Why can't you do it with spells and rituals? Luna shook her head at me, her blonde hair swinging like a curtain. Most people would be ecstatic to know they have the level of power that you do. And here I am dragging you like a recalcitrant toddler to your lessons. I snorted. I'd only thrown one tantrum, hadn't I? I just want to read cards and take underwater photographs. Is that too much to ask? Yes, it is. When you are ignoring your goddess-given gift, it damn well is. I'm not saying you have to start joining me on all my rituals and start mixing up magic tonics. I'm just asking you to continue to learn how to safely practice magic. Goddess forbid you get stuck in another situation and try to run a spell all willy-nilly and whatnot. Luna shuddered delicately. Did I mention she does everything delicately? I probably did. I can't imagine that sleepy Tequila Key is going to have too much drama after the last few incidents. I suspect we'll be cruising along just fine for a while here, I said, crossing to examine a box full of crystals on the counter. Tequila Key was one of the overlooked keys on the trek down to the tourist hotspot of Key West. Years ago, an over-exuberant mayor had posted a sign off the highway proclaiming, "Tequila makes it better," forever sealing our status as an ignored destination. Tourists would hop out of their cars, take a silly picture by the sign, and continue the cruise down to Key West. The crab shack guy who'd set up next to the sign was making a killing, though. Tequila Key is divided into two distinct sections: the old section, where the likes of me lived, and the new section, recently renamed Port Atticus, which housed whitewashed mansions and manicured lawns. A few years back, the Whittiers, one of Tequila Key's founding families, had begun a campaign to invite wealthy homeowners down to Tequila Key by offering a break on property taxes. It had worked, and I had to admit, I didn't mind the tax break. Even if it meant I had to put up with the Prudy and Theodore Whittiers of the world. Luna and I ran our Luna Rose Potions and Tarot shop in the older section of Tequila Key. We'd renovated a small clapboard cottage with two front doors to turn it into a divided shop. On Luna's side, everything was white on white on white. With whitewashed floors and some gold accents, her shop was all elegance. In it, she sold handmade soaps, tonics, elixirs, and other healing gifts. Maybe she put a little charm into each as well, but that's why they commanded such a high price. People were willing to pay more when magic was involved. My side of the shop looked like the room of a rowdy teenager who refused to clean up. There was lots of leopard print, purple velvet, and crowded shelves full of various psychic antiquities and oddities that my mother sent me from her travels around the world. I'm certain that most of them had more magic than I even knew what to do with. But Abigail Rose played her cards close to her chest. I'd only recently discovered that, aside from my mother being one of the most famous psychics in the world, she was also a sorceress. Thanks for the heads up, Mom. Luna was determined to hunt Abigail down and have a major talk with her, but my mother was off in another corner of the world. Myanmar at the moment, I believe. She was on the yacht of someone dangerously wealthy and quietly famous, and I'm sure she and my father were having the time of their lives. Diving's good there, I hear. Stop trying to distract me. What's the deal with the research team? Luna asked as she began to unpack her box of crystals, holding each one up to the light and examining it carefully before setting it down on the counter. A professor from some fancy schmancy institute in London contacted Trace, if you can believe that. It seems he's discovered an old manuscript, a treasure map of sorts, that leads to an undiscovered shipwreck. It's believed to be from a Spanish treasure fleet. If what he says is true, it's likely that the shipwreck could hold billions of dollars in salvageable treasure, I said, a shiver of excitement and anticipation racing through me. And they want you to document it? Luna asked. They want me to document it. Apparently, they like Trace's reputation as a dive master, and they researched my website to see if I was capable of the level of underwater photography they're looking for. It seems I am, and they've rented Trace's boat out privately for the next couple weeks, along with a generous stipend for my time. Well, shit! Add scientific researcher to your resume, Luna squealed. I feel like I already have enough things on my resume. It was true, too. Between being a full-time psychic and selling underwater pictures across the world, more work was the last thing I needed. But I couldn't hide the fact that I was flattered the big shots at the Research Institute were willing to have me catalog their treasure hunt. You're going on a treasure hunt, Luna pointed out, moving across the room with a crystal in her hand. It's like every kid's dream come true. Every adult's, too. Could you imagine the split of the treasure? How does that work? Will you get any part of it? Hard to say. It depends on how far offshore the wreck is. If it's close to land, Florida can claim it. If it isn't, well, it's up in the air. I know Trace said we have some contracts to go over in the morning, which I assume details the fine print. It would be cool to keep a piece or two, though. A piece or two? Luna snorted and put her hands on her hips. A gold doubloon is not just a piece or two of some silly treasure. That's big bucks you're talking about. Well, so? I mean, if there is loads of treasure on the ship, what's one little doubloon? Chapter 2. It appeared that it was a big deal after all. The gold doubloon, that is. The next morning, I found myself huddled over contracts at Beans, the local coffee shop. Trace had insisted on meeting me there, instead of at the dive boat, which is how I knew he was taking this venture very seriously. "Nothing? Nothing at all?" I squeaked, raising my eyebrows at Trace over the contracts stacked in front of us. We were seated at a small table stuck in the corner of the coffee shop. Regulars bustled in and out, waving a hand to us in greeting, as Trace leaned back and crossed tattooed and well-tanned arms over his chest. "You can't take any of the treasure," Trace said patiently. I bit back a sigh. One of these days, I was going to have to get a hold on my attraction for Trace. I was in the middle of a relationship with a very hot and decidedly yummy millionaire who had pretty much everything a woman could want. So why was I still looking sideways at my dive buddy? Trace and I had been friends ever since he'd moved to Tequila Key 6 or 7 years ago. With his easygoing manner, tall, lanky frame, and killer blue eyes, women flocked to him on sight. He'd built up a strong reputation for being an excellent dive master, and together we'd explored a lot of unknown spots, him just for the pleasure of diving without leading a crew, and me for working on my underwater photography. Our friendship had been easygoing and platonic through the years, with me often offering counsel on his various love interests. It wasn't until Cash, my current boyfriend, had come to town and lasered in on me that Trace had suddenly made his move. Shitty timing, right? Months later, we found ourselves in a standoff of sorts. I continued to date Cash, and Trace was currently dating some slip of a girl who liked to wear thong bikinis. But I'd be lying if I said my view of Trace hadn't shifted just a bit. "Earth to Althea," Trace said, snapping his fingers under my nose. "Sorry." I shook my head and focused back on the contracts at hand. "So you're saying a gold doubloon is worth how much?"
"In the current market, depending on age, condition, and what boat it comes off of, I'd say close to $1 million.
"For just one of them?" I squeaked, fanning my face dramatically with my hand. Trace laughed, his teeth flashing white in his tanned face.
"Just one of them."
"This is off Treasure Coast, right? The 11 ships that were lost transporting pearls, emeralds, and gold from Cuba to Spain?" "What?" I'd been known to listen in on a history class once in a while. And I liked to know the history of wrecks in my area. As a diver, you never know what you might stumble across.
"Yes, though 4 of the 11 ships have never been found. Stupid commanding officer," Trace snorted.
He was right, too. The commanding officer of the fleet had, senselessly, decided to sail right before hurricane season. In a matter of 1 week, all 11 ships had been lost, along with the lives of everyone on board. It was one of the greatest tragedies to ever befall a treasure fleet expedition. And there was still treasure to be found. Billions of dollars worth, or so it seemed from the contracts I was currently reading.
"Though I don't think it's the doubloons they are really after,"
Trace added as an afterthought. "What else are they looking for?"
"Well..."
Trace ran his hand through his sun-streaked hair and looked around before bending closer and lowering his voice.
"I'm fairly certain it may involve a legend of sorts."
"A legend?" I breathed. This venture had suddenly taken on a whole new aspect. "From, like, a saint or something? From where?"
"You know how certain items in history have legends surrounding them? Like the Hope Diamond or the Holy Grail?"
I nodded, gesturing with my iced coffee for him to continue.
"Well, there's an emerald that is mentioned in here. El Serpiente. I did some research, and, well, if we find it, watch out."
"The serpent?" I asked, translating the Spanish phrase.
Yes, green stone named for the green-eyed serpent. From what I can remember of my shoddy history class, when the Spanish invaded Mexico to gather treasure, somehow the history or legends get intermixed on Quetzalcoatl, the Aztec feather serpent god.
Sure, I've heard of him.
I'm not entirely sure if he's strictly a Mexican or an Aztec god, but the legends of this god were taken back to Spain by explorers, along with an emerald the size of my fist.
Trace held up his fist, tightly closed.
The emerald is said to have been handed down as the stone of Quetzalcoatl, who is considered the god of the morning star, of light, truth, and justice. It's believed that whoever possesses the stone becomes almost godlike himself, that it imbues the wearer with great powers.
No, I breathed.
People have been searching for El Serpiente for hundreds of years. The stone, once held by Cortes himself, was supposedly lost along with many other Aztec treasures and relics.
But it wasn't?
Trace shook his head. This professor seems to think the stone ended up on one of the boats that was heading from Cuba to Spain in 1715 before the storms sunk them.
I let that sit with me for a moment.
So, what you're saying is that a legendary emerald, presumably with godlike powers, has been tracked to a wreck off the coast of Florida?
Trace nodded sagely.
Holy shit, I breathed, taking a sip of my iced coffee as I absorbed this news.
Is it like the Holy Grail? People can live forever?
Trace shrugged one shoulder, his lips pressed in a tight line.
I don't really know. All I know is that I had to sign a confidentiality agreement to even read through this contract, and that it is some major shit.
And I shouldn't even be talking to you about it without your signature on a confidentiality agreement.
I shivered as his words went through me. This was big deal stuff right here. Leaders of nations had sought this emerald for centuries, and we might be the ones to find it.
Oh, I'm so in, I gushed.
I mean, what could go wrong?
Famous last words. I rolled my eyes at myself. I should know better than to think something like that. And thinking it was just as bad as saying it out loud, as far as I'm concerned.
We'll sign the confidentiality agreement first, then we'll dig deeper, Trace said, looking over his shoulder as he slid the paper at me.
I scanned the single-page document, a fairly boilerplate non-disclosure agreement, and signed it quickly before pushing the paper back at him.
Talk.
Okay, so this professor, Professor Johansson? Well, I think he has a pretty major backer on this project. He referred to it only as a private investor and stressed that money was no object. I can't even imagine how much El Serpiente would fetch at auction, but I'm sure it'd be a pretty penny.
I tapped my finger against my lip as I thought about it.
I know that there's a famous emerald up at the Smithsonian or something. Let me Google it. I pulled out my iPhone and typed it in. Gashala Emerald. 858 carats.
Wow, it doesn't even list the value. That's a huge stone, I murmured, scrolling through more information.
Here's another tidbit. The Spanish royal family liked to wear emeralds to add some much-needed color to the dark clothes they wore. The Nuestra Señora de Atocha. I nodded in recognition of the name of a famous shipwreck off the coast of the Keys, which sunk in 1622, was carrying over 6,000 emeralds destined for the Spanish royal family. The emeralds discovered from the ship have been valued at over $400 million. I raised an eyebrow at Trace.
Yowza.
I'll say. So, we know that Spain's royal family liked emeralds, and there's a famous one rumored to carry mythological powers of an Aztec god. Professor Johansson from London,
who is being bankrolled by an anonymous investor, believes he's located the famous emerald, plus whatever other treasures this shipwreck may hold. Am I summing that up correctly? Trace took a bite of his bagel and leaned back, crossing his arms over his chest.
Sounds about right.
Okay, let's muddle through these contracts. I don't like to sign anything unless my lawyer goes over it too.
I already had my lawyer go through them. Nothing dodgy, just that they are very specific about the confidentiality of the expedition, that all images are owned by them, not us, and that all information on the whereabouts of the wreck is exclusive information to them.
Basically, we saw nothing, we heard nothing, and we know nothing. I grumbled as I swirled my spoon around in my yogurt parfait. My psychic senses were telling me that this was going to be big trouble. And yet, the little girl deep inside of me screamed that she wanted to go on a treasure hunt.
Hard to turn down an honest-to-God treasure hunt, isn't it? I mused, pointing a finger at Trace.
His smile flashed across his face again.
I knew you wouldn't be able to resist.
May the goddess help us all, I said to Trace as I held my hand across the table to shake his, ignoring the tingles that went through me when his hand touched my palm. When do I meet this professor?
Tomorrow morning. We'll pick him up from his hotel. Be ready.
Trace sent me a cheeky wink.
We ride at dawn.
Chapter 3. Even though I knew the potential for danger was high, I couldn't help but be excited about the expedition. I wondered what El Serpiente looked like. Was it set in gold, cut or uncut? I daydreamed about a mythological serpent god dancing around a fire, wearing the emerald around his neck. Quetzalcoatl. The stuff of legends, really. I pedaled my bike lazily away from downtown Tequila Key, turning down a lane to cruise by Miss Elva's house to see if she was out front. Miss Elva, Tequila Key's resident voodoo priestess, had an attitude larger than life, and the wardrobe to match. I also considered her one of my best friends.
Here comes trouble. Awful early for you to be out and about on a Sunday, ain't it? Shouldn't you be at church? Or wound around that handsome hunk of eye candy you've hooked?
Miss Elva slapped her knee as she hollered to me from where she sat on the front porch of her two-story shingle home. She'd placed a comfy rocking chair with bright cushions in her favorite corner of the porch, and often spent time watching the world go by. She didn't welcome visitors all that often, if the hard, straight-backed, single wooden chair, with no cushions, mind you, was any indication. But I knew my presence was always welcome, for the most part.
Church, aren't you the funny one? I'm communing with nature on this beautiful morning that the goddess has bestowed upon us.
I grinned up at Miss Elva as I perched my bike against the railing of her porch steps and climbed up to see her. I eyed the visitor's chair and decided to stand instead. Leaning back against the railing, I crossed my arms over my chest and took in today's outfit. Miss Elva smiled up at me, a brilliant orange caftan, with peacock feathers around the wrists and aligning the hem, covering her generous body. A matching peacock feather was tucked in her hair amidst the intricate braids woven around her head and up to a bun at the top. She looked every inch the regal queen, and a part of me wished I could be Miss Elva when I grew up.
Looking smashing, as always, I said.
Miss Elva drew a critical eye over my outfit.
I can't say the same for you, child. What did you do? Roll right out of bed and go for a bike ride?
Hey, it's not that bad, I said, smoothing a hand down my rumpled black maxi dress.
Child, please. I know what I'm looking at, don't I?
Now. What's got you up and about this morning? Why aren't you with Cash?
Cash left early this morning to go up to Miami to sign a contract. He should be back tomorrow afternoon and then staying for a whole week this time. It'll be nice to have him around.
He's still looking at property down here?
I shrugged. He had mentioned it a while ago,
but the conversation about him moving here had stalled out recently. We'll see. Miss Alva harumphed and rocked once in her chair before looking back at me.
You just out for coffee, then?
Actually, I met with Trace. We've got a... I thought about it for a moment. I'd signed a confidentiality agreement, so I had to be careful what I said. But Miss Alva was old magic. So if I told her to read my mind, it wasn't technically breaking the contract. What am I thinking of? I asked Miss Alva in lieu of answering her question. I focused on the emerald and its name, hoping she would pluck it from my head. Miss Alva's pretty brown eyes narrowed as she studied me for a moment. Then her eyebrows rose and she let out a low whistle.
Tell me you aren't trying to find El Serpiente.
Bingo. I breathed out a sigh of relief, happy that I had stayed within the terms of my contract. There was a lot of money on the table, and I could see a vacation to Europe or someplace lovely hovering on the horizon once I got paid. For the most part, I made more than enough money to live on. My townhouse was paid off, I had no car payment, and I had a cushy savings in the bank. Don't let the stereotypes of psychics fool you. The tarot world can be a very lucrative business. It didn't hurt that Luna was excellent with money and kept an eagle eye on my finances as well as her own. But still, it wasn't every day you were offered a $50,000 paycheck for a few weeks of work.
$50,000? Woo, honey! What have you gone and gotten yourself into now?
Miss Alva tilted her head at me and began to rock her chair in earnest, a sure sign she was becoming agitated. I sighed. Who was I kidding? I was totally going to tell Miss Alva all the details. With my luck, she'd probably be the one who'd save me or find El Serpiente. It was never a bad thing to have Miss Alva in my back pocket. It's a research team from London, led by one Professor Johansson. It's all very hush-hush. Trace will help them find their coordinates and lead the dives, and I'll be taking pictures and documenting everything. They were clear that they own all the rights to the treasure, as well as the copyright to all the pictures.
What do you know about that stone?
Just what Trace told me over coffee this morning. I've come right from there with no time to research it more.
That there stone does not need to be fallen into the wrong hands. Powerful stuff you're messing in, Miss Thing.
Miss Alva's rocking picked up pace. I mean, is it really an Aztec god's stone? I wasn't about to try and pronounce the name that Trace had managed to pronounce at breakfast.
So the legend goes, the feathered serpent. He always wore a particular talisman, and the stone was rumored to be an emerald as big as an ostrich egg. Many spells and great powers were said to be infused into that stone. It's not a thing to be trifled with. It can take over, you know.
I raised an eyebrow at her, then turned to scan the street when I heard a car door slam. I held up my hand to wave to the neighbor, then turned back to Miss Alva. Take over? How? Explain, please.
You know, stones are meant for their masters, that type of stone at least. If it can sense it's more powerful than you, it can take over. For example, if it falls into the wrong hands, it may feed off the strongest emotion of the person holding it. Say the person is really greedy, which I'm assuming they would be if they're trying to get their hands on El Serpiente. Well, the stone can feed off that and compel the person to do far more harm than their original intentions. It takes a powerful hand to rule a powerful stone. You must remember that while they are tools and talismans, they do have their own energy. Some are conduits for energy and some give off energy. El Serpiente is both.
I dug my toe into a floorboard of her porch. This is bad, then?
I suggest that if you find it, you be the one to recover it. And before you do so, get some training from Luna on how to hold a stone in a stasis state. She'll teach you the spell. You'll need it, most likely.
I highly doubt the research team will let me hold the stone.
And I'm telling you that it's your job to get your hands on it before they do. This is bad. Some things are meant to remain uncovered, and this is one of them. It's meant to stay buried.
Here I thought this was going to be some miraculous recovery. Maybe something that could be added to a museum. And now you're making it sound like it's going to take over the world.
Child, when that stone was stolen and on its trip back to Spain, 11 ships sank and hundreds of men died in a matter of days. Days. Think about that. What would possess a seafaring man who studied the weather and commanded ships all his grown life to set sail right before hurricane season? He was blinded by the riches, blinded by the power, and blinded by the stone. El Serpiente wanted him to sail, just like it wanted them all to die. The stone never should have been taken from that temple.
You know that's what happened, don't you?
It was stolen from an Aztec temple, and it cost the Spanish fleet their lives.
Her words made goosebumps rise on my arm, even though the mid-morning heat was already close to 80 degrees. Sure, the stuff of legends gets added to and embossed over the years, but this was Miss Elva, and she always gave it to you straight. You think I should back out? It wasn't really a question, but I had to know.
I think that if it's going to be found, better for it to be by someone like you, who's more comfortable with magical things and can diffuse some of its power for a while. At least until you can get it to Luna and me, where we can work our magic on it.
What makes you think they'll let me get that far with the stone? Miss Elva leveled her gaze at me.
You'll have to make it happen.
Great. Real stinking great.
You signed the contract, honey child, not me. But you know I'll help you.
I blew out a breath and nodded my thanks. Tell Rafe I said hi, by the way, wherever he is. Rafe was Miss Elva's pirate ghost and a regular fixture by her side. He was deeply in love with Miss Elva, loved to tell tales of his seafaring days, and was an all-around lecherous old coot. But we all loved him. Well, those of us who could see and hear him, that is.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.